Okay. So, thank you very much for having me. I chose for this talk the name The Camera Metaphor of Spatial Attention. It's a bit of a provocative name because it contrasts the most common metaphor for spatial attention, which is a spotlight. So, attention is usually envisioned as a spotlight which moves through space. And usually, we can voluntarily shift our attention. So for example, if we're searching for a red letter, then we can, once we detect the letter, we can voluntarily shift our attention towards that letter. Now, once we shift our attention, a second process commences called attentional engagement. Now, attentional engagement has been described by various authors doing different things, and Treisman would have said that this is the intelligent engagement is what binds the features together. We would say that it extracts the fine-grained details, but we can think of attentional engagement as the gateway to higher-level processes. So once we have attentional engagement, we can identify that the target is an aim. And if we voluntarily shift our attention, it is reasonable to assume that attentional engagement will necessarily follow a shift of attention, therefore a spotlight. However, sometimes our attention might be involuntarily shifted or involuntarily captured. So in this example, it's not that the letter itself is red, but it's surrounded by a red placeholder. So in that case, attention is involuntarily captured. And it begs the question, if we don't shift voluntarily, if attention is captured, do we necessarily engage attention as well? And would we identify that the letter here is an X? So that's the main question we want to ask, whether we can dissociate attentional shifting and attentional engagement. So the first part of the talk, we're going to look at evidence for shift engagement dissociation using an attentional blink paradigm. And next, we're going to talk about what this relates to the N2PC component of the event-related potential. And in part B, we're going to talk about the role of task relevance and the role of consciousness. So first, let me, if you don't know what is the attentional blink, so let me describe it. So in the attentional blink, participants usually view a stream of stimuli appearing one after the other, and have to report two targets. So in this case, we have to report the two red targets. So the defining feature is them being red. And what's important is that the temporal lag between the target is manipulated. So it can be either a close lag or farther away. And the main results here, the usual results found in the attentional blink paradigm, is when we map T2 accuracy, that is the second target, as a function of the lag, we find that at lags 2 and 3, we have a dip, a disruption to identification, which dissipates after about 500 to 600 milliseconds. So that's the attentional blink. What we did is to use a two streams of stimuli instead of one. So for each frame, we have frames appearing for approximately 60 milliseconds with 40 milliseconds ISI. And after a short while, this is T1. So the first target is to report whether the two digits are the same or are they different. And after a short while, we get the second target, which is a red letter. So in both cases, the defining feature is red. And of course, the lag between them is manipulated. Now importantly, prior to the second target, we have another event, which is a cue, a placeholder, that shares the target's color. And that placeholder can either appear in the same location as the target or in a different location than the target. And of course, the lag is manipulated. We chose two lags, two inside the blink and seven outside the blink. Now with this paradigm, we can ask questions both about attentional capture and about attentional engagement. So for attentional capture, we're going to look at what's called a location benefit. And what is assumed is if the cue captures attention to its location, then accuracy will be higher when the cue appears in the same location as the target relative to a different location. So if we direct our attention to the correct location, we'll be more accurate, we'll have this benefit. So this is calculated as same versus different location. And the question is whether the attentional blink disrupts attentional capture. So if it does, we would expect a smaller location benefit at lag 2 than at lag 7. The second question is about attentional engagement. So we're asking whether attention is engaged in this cue. And the way we're going to measure it is by what's called distractor identity intrusions. That is, what is the likelihood to report the letter E instead of the letter N? So out of all of my L's, how many of these L's will be the letter E or just a random mistake? And we assume that if we engage attention in this cue, then we would report the letter E more often. And again, we can ask whether the attentional blink disrupts attentional engagement, and if it does, we expect less identity intrusions at lag 2 than at lag 7. So, now that we have the two measures, we can see, first of all, how attentional capture fares during the blink. So what we have is T2 accuracy at lag 2 and at lag 7, either in the same location as the cue or in a different location as the cue. And first of all, at lag 7, that is outside the blink, we see this large location benefit. So accuracy is higher when we're in the same location as the target than in a different location. Okay. And when we're inside the blink, we see the same location benefit. So, of course, this is not significant difference, and we calculate the base factor for the non-hypothesis, and there is support that there is no difference between the two conditions. So, from these results, what we conclude is that attentional capture, as indicated by location benefit, is unaffected by the attentional link. So, the attentional link does not affect our ability to shift our attention. Next, we're looking at attentional engagement. So again, I remind you, we're looking at the percentage out of all the L's that we report the letter inside the cue instead of the target. So this is the likelihood to report this letter out of the L's. And at lag 7, 15% of all L's are identity intrusions. And at lag 2, this percentage went down. So what we conclude is that attentional engagement, as implicated by identity intrusions, is indeed disrupted by the attentional blink. Next, we wanted to replicate these results with reaction times. So in this paradigm, it's very similar. The main difference is that T2 is unmasked. And when in attentional blink paradigm, T2 is unmasked, the attentional blink is expressed as longer reaction time and not lower accuracy. So accuracy is very near ceiling in this case. And again, we have T1. In this case, again, we have to report whether they're the same or different. It's only an X and O. And T2, this target. And now we have to do a speeded response. So the response is whether the target is larger than 5 or smaller than 5. And we have the cue that can either be in the same location or in a different location. And of course, the lag is once again manipulated. So now we're looking at attentional capture in reaction times. So this is T2 reaction time. And now we expect that if there is attentional capture, reaction times will be faster for the same location condition relative to the different location condition. And at lag 7, indeed, that's what we find. And at lag 2, longer reaction time, but the location benefit is once again of the same size. And there was no difference between these conditions. So again, we conclude that attentional capture is unaffected by the attentional link. Now, to examine attentional engagement, we once again focus on attentional engagement in the distractor. Now, because accuracy is almost assuming, we can't examine identity intrusions. Instead, what we're looking at is a compatibility effect. So this, the digit inside the cube can either be compatible with the target, in this case, larger than 5, or incompatible with the target, in this case, smaller than 5. And we expect that if we engage in the queue, then we'll find a compatibility effect, and if not, we will not. Now, in this analysis, we only took the 50% more fastest trials, because previous studies in Dominique's lab found that the compatibility effect is very short-lived. So the chances to find the compatibility effect are much higher in this time range. So at lag 7, we do find a small yet highly significant compatibility effect. And this compatibility effect completely disappears when we're inside the pin.
Fastest?
The 50% pair condition, fastest trials. Yes.
Fastest.
Yeah. So you can see the reaction times here are a bit faster than the previous slide.
What happens in the slow ones?
In the slow ones, the compatibility effect just dissipates. So it depends on the paradigm, but in this case, in a 50% slower trial, then it dissipates. But again, what interests us is that even in the fastest trials, at lag 2, there was no compatibility effect. So again, attentional engagement, as indicated by distractor compatibility effect, was disrupted by the attentional pain. So our first conclusion from this study is that attentional capture and attentional shifting is unaffected by the attentional link. However, attentional engagement is indeed disrupted by the attentional link. So this means that attentional capture and attentional engagement can indeed be dissociated. And attentional link can be used as a tool to dissociate between the two processes. In the second study, we want to examine how can we use this paradigm to say something interesting about the N2PC. So the N2PC is a component in the ELPs and has various interpretations. So various authors say it means something else, but it is routinely taken as an indicator of spatial attention, regardless of the exact interpretation. And our question is, are spatial shifts necessarily associated with an N2PC? And we can use the paradigm to examine it. So we used a very similar paradigm, only that we had two possible lags between the queue and the target. So it can either be lag 1, that is, the queue is close to the target, or lag 6, where it's farther away. And first of all, we replicated our behavioral results. So when the queue is at lag 1 from the target, we find intact attentional capture, but disrupted attentional engagement. Next, we want to see what is the N2PC to the queue, that is locked to the queue, when the queue is farther away from the target. So in this case, there is no overlap between the signal coming from the target and the signal coming from the distractor. So the N2PC is locked to the queue, and we have a contralateral wave and an ipsilateral wave, and the N2PC is calculated as the difference wave between them, and in this case, we're looking at the time range of 180 milliseconds to 280 milliseconds, which is the standard time frame. So the main question is, what happens inside the blink and outside the blink? And first of all, outside the blink, we see at lag 7, we see that the queue results in this nice N2PC, which is also significant. However, inside the blink, we see a suppressed N2PC, and this difference is significant. So what happens is, even though the location benefit indicating attentional shifting is intact, the N2PC is indeed suppressed, very similarly to attentional engagement. So the Q-locked N2BC component was suppressed by the attention mode. And this study makes us conclude is that the N2BC is indeed disruptive during the day. But it does not reflect attentional shifting, as is routinely noted by other authors. Instead, it corresponds with attentional engagement. Now, from these data alone, we can't say that the N2BC is attentional engagement, only that at least it's correlated with attentional engagement. Maybe it's a more downstream process than attentional engagement. Okay, so in the first part, we saw that spatial shifting and attentional engagement can be associated. This led us to ask an even more radical question, which is, can attentional engagement be withheld completely following a shift? In the first studies we found it can be disrupted, but can it be withheld completely? And in the first study, we'll ask about the role of task relevance, and in the second study, about the role of access consciousness. So first of all, about task relevance. So the role of relevance in guiding attention has been studied for more than two decades. And for example, Falk and Hamilton had this cueing paradigm. Okay, so in this case, we have to search for the red letter. And prior to the letter, either a relevant color distractor appears, that is, the cherry in the target's color, or an irrelevant color distractor. And what they find is that there was no evidence of capture by any relevant color cue. So this finding has been replicated many, many times before and was taken to indicate that a cue that is outside the attentional set does not guide attention, does not capture attention. However, recently, work by Gaspin et al., they suggested that what matters is the target screen. So they suggested that if the search is difficult enough, and in this case you see that we're looking for a red letter among pink and orange distractors, then we might find evidence of attentional capture by an irrelevant color cue. And indeed, in many experiments, they did find evidence of capture by a cue that did not share the target's color. So using this paradigm, we wanted to look at whether capture by a cue that is completely irrelevant to the task would it result in attentional engagement. So in this paradigm, we're using a very similar to paradigm to Gaspin et al., only we added a relevant color cue. So first of all, we're looking at the location effect. And these columns are the relevant color, and this is the irrelevant color. And participants are looking for the red letter, and so the red cue is relevant and the gray cue is relevant. And we can see that in both cases, we have a location benefit. However, you can see that the location benefit is much larger for the relevant cue than the irrelevant cue. But at least we did find evidence that the irrelevant cue captured attention. Next, we want to ask about, again, attentional engagement using a compatibility effect. So you can see that in this case, for example, let's follow this cue. The cue signals this letter. Now, participants have to respond whether the letter is an E or an H. So in this case, the cue indicates an incompatible distractor. So once again, we can look at compatibility effects as index of attentional engagement. And what we find is that in the relevant color cue, we find evidence of compatibility effects. Again, small effects, but highly significant. Whereas in the irrelevant color, there is absolutely no evidence. And this kind of reverse compatibility effect is non-significant, and there was strong support for the null hypothesis. And of course, the difference between them is significant. So in this case, we find that even though attention has shifted towards the irrelevant color cue, there was no compatibility effect, that there is no evidence of attentional engagement. However, in this example, we only search for a red target. So perhaps attentional engagement is not dependent or contingent on the attentional set. Maybe it is contingent about something else, like saliency. So in the next experiment, we had another presentation, so this is a replication of the previous example, but we also added a situation where we're looking for the gray distract, for the gray letter, among white and black distractors. So half of the participants did the first task and half did the second task. Now here it wasn't comfortable to put all the data in figures, so I put them in tables. So first of all, let's focus on this one first. So first of all, we can see the location effect, okay? When the queue is compatible with the task. And we see a nod, this is the location effect itself. So the same versus different location, and we see a large location benefit when it's relevant, and a large location benefit when it's relevant. And also in the compatibility effect, we can see a nice compatibility effect when it's relevant, and a nice compatibility effect when it's relevant. Now when we're looking at the location effect, we can see that in both cases, there's a positive location effect. This one is rather small, okay, but the difference between them was far, far from significant. Okay? But in both cases, we did find evidence that there was a location effect. That is, both cues, when they were irrelevant, captured attention. And again, the interesting question is whether they will produce a compatibility effect. And when they were irrelevant, once again, absolutely no evidence of a compatibility effect in the relevant color condition. So in both cases, we don't find evidence of attentional engagement, but perhaps this is caused because the location benefit is so much smaller. Perhaps there's a magnifying effect. Maybe we need to cross a certain threshold in order to get an attentional engagement. So what we did is we divided out of all our experiments, we had three experiments, so we looked at the 30 participants with the larger location benefit and the relevant color condition, and the 30 participants with the smallest location benefit and the relevant color condition. And again, in the irrelevant color condition, the largest location benefit, the smallest location benefit. And what we're looking at is that for the smallest location benefit group in the relevant color queue, the location benefit was approximately 39 milliseconds, but the compatibility effect was significant. For the largest location benefit group among the relevant color queue condition, the location benefit was about 38 milliseconds, so very close to the location benefit of the smallest group, but again, there was absolutely no evidence of attentional engagement. If anything, a reverse compatibility effect, but again, there was no evidence to support that this is anything but spurious. So our conclusion from this study is that spatial attention can be involuntarily captured by an irrelevant color cue. That is a cue that is completely outside our task set. However, attentional engagement is contingent on the match with attentional set. So even when attentional capture is not contingent, attentional engagement is contingent. The last study we wanted to do, and this is still in progress, is to assess the role of access consciousness. So this study relies on a previous study using the continuous flash suppression paradigm. So in the continuous flash suppression paradigm, we have a stimuli appearing in one side on each eye, so we have a suppressed eye and a non-suppressed eye. And in the non-suppressed eye, we see the target stimulus. So we need to look for the red letter, okay? But in the suppressed eye, that is something that is outside our consciousness, we're not consciously perceiving it all the time, we have a cue, okay? So usually the CFS paradigm, the continuous flash suppression paradigm, is used to completely suppress appears in the suppressed eye. However, we use a liminal paradigm where the cue that appears in the suppressed eye is sometimes seen and sometimes not seen. And we rely on a previous study from Dominique's lab where they saw that attentional capture occurs independently of access consciousness. So first of all, we have the presentation and the circles filling in. And then we have the cue display. And I remind you, this is in the suppressed eye. And then we have the target display. And participants have to give two responses. The first response is to the target. So in this case, whether the target appears to the right or to the left, whether the team is shifted to the right or to the left. And next, they have to give a pass indication whether they were aware of the cue's appearance. So they might be 0, completely unaware, or 1 to 3, somewhat aware of the cue. And what Dominique found in this study is that attentional capture, as indicated by location benefit, is completely independent of conscious perception. So you can be completely unaware of the cue or completely aware of the cue, and the location benefit will be the same. So we continued with this line of thought and examined, again, attentional engagement as indicated by a compatibility effect. So we're looking for the red target, and again, a cue appears in the suppressed eye in one of the locations. So in this case, this letter is incompatible because it's turned to the left. And these letters are neutral. So in this case, we examined the compatibility effect not as compatible versus incompatible, rather than incompatible versus neutral. And first of all, we got a nice division of awareness choices. So about a third of the trials, people were completely unaware of the cue's appearance, and the rest, they were aware to some degree, and a third of the trials were completely aware of the cue's appearance. So first of all, we replicated the results, the previous results, where the location benefit is completely independent of consciousness. So again, both location benefits are significant, and this difference is not significant. On the other hand, when we were aware of the cue, we find a significant compatibility effect. But when we were unaware of the cue, we probably saw where this was going, we had absolutely no compatibility effect and some support for the null hypothesis, and this difference was significant. So what we're saying from this study is that attentional capture is independent of conscious perception, from conscious perception of the attention-grabbing cue. On the other hand, attentional engagement is dependent on conscious perception of the attention-grabbing cue. However, some caveats. First of all, we're talking specifically about the continuous flash suppression paradigm. And it is known that this paradigm cuts off awareness in a very, very, the beginning of the process. So we're starting now to look at another paradigm, the backward masking paradigm, and there is some initial evidence that attentional engagement is not exactly dependent on consciousness, but more likely correlated with consciousness. So it depends on when you cut off awareness. If you cut it off very early in the process, you see this complete dependence, but if you cut it off later, then you might not see this dependence. But even after attention shifted towards a cue that shared the target's color, attentional engagement, at least in this case, was correlated with consciousness. So again, we see evidence that even though attention has shifted already, we do not necessarily engage attention. So attentional engagement, can we be withheld following a shift of attention? To summarize, attentional engagement can be suppressed in conditions, in certain conditions where attentional shifting is intact. This is the results of study 1 and study 2. Also, attentional engagement is contingent on detection of potentially relevant information. So this is actually something to me seems rather, it makes sense. Because attentional engagement, you can think of it as a more costly resource than attentional shifting. And if attentional engagement is a costly resource, we want to have a higher threshold when we engage our attention and when we do not engage our attention. So having intentional engagement contingent on the task set seems to make sense to us. And this means that attention does not operate like a spotlight. So a spotlight means that anywhere we shift our attention, we necessarily engage our attention. Instead, we suggest a camera metaphor of attention, that we can shift our attention, that is, move the zoom lens around, but we have a second process, pressing the shutter button, which reflects the attentional engagement part, which helps us to process the information, retain the information, and so on. Okay, so thank you very much for listening. Thanks to Dominique Lamy, which is an awesome advisor, and my collaborators, and my lab members, and my PhD advisory committee. Thank you very much.